And a breather for the startup community, the government has eased the angel tax norms. The centre has released a series of measures aimed at making life easier for budding business. First and foremost, funding in startups by all investors will be exempt from angel tax up to an aggregate limit of 25 crore rupees. Now, till now, that exemption cap stood at 10 crore rupees. Secondly, the government has widened the definition of startups. Now, an entity will be considered a startup for up to 10 years from the date of incorporation. Now, this against the existing period of 7 years. Also, an entity will be considered a startup if its turnover in any financial year has not exceeded 100 crore rupees. Currently, that cap stands at 25 crores. Fourth, investments into eligible startups by listed companies with a net worth of 100 crore rupees shall be exempt from angel tax beyond the limit of 25 crore rupees. Now, similarly, investments by non-resident Indians and alternate investment funds will also be exempt beyond that limit of 25 crores. However, one concern remains unanswered. The government hasn't made any announcement on the contentious issue of Section 68 of the Income Tax Act, which deals with unexplained fund receipts. Here's what some experts had to say.
My first question to you is, when will CBDT come up with the notification which has been...
Oh, very shortly, I think. That essentially cites and gives a reference to this notification of the DIPB, BP IIT, and just be a matter of days.
Right. Because this notification covers most of the issues raised by startups, what happens to the existing tax notices that have gone out? If you can just explain that issue.
Yes, you see, where a tax assessment has been completed and a demand notice has been sent, we understand that there are about 100 odd cases like that. Now, you know, it's not possible through any other administrative mechanism to put a stop to that process. They will have, those companies will have to file an appeal under the Income Tax Act and get their case sorted out there. That's the only channel available.
Right.
What we are doing administratively is that till such time as their appeal is decided, we will not enforce recovery of the tax demand. We have issued instructions to our officers on that. Also, we are getting the appeals to be decided early on priority.
Right, sir. What about Section 68? Because there were some issues raised by startups from Section 68 as well. Do we see any policy action on that as well? If you can explain the Section 68 issue with respect to startups.
Well, Section 68, I think as the Secretary DIPB also mentioned, it's in provision on the Act for the last 50 years, 60 years. Now, that section is not peculiar to startups. It has nothing to do with startups really. It has to do with every taxpayer, every SSE, who claims to have received some money as an unsecured loan or as an equity investment or whatever. And that person is then called upon under the law to provide some clarification as to who is given the money. Is that person, does he have the capacity to give that money? The creditworthiness of that person, and to show that the transaction is genuine. Because you will understand and appreciate that this is a very fine way of putting your own unaccounted money back into the business. So obviously the law requires the company or the taxpayer to explain from where he got the money and who was this person and whether that person had the capacity to do it.
Right. So Section 68 exemption per se is not possible given
it can't be possible because it affects all taxpayers, not just startup companies. It affects individuals, firms, other companies. It affects the largest companies of the country also.
Right, right. In the notification, one very interesting thing that you have done, and that is at the crux of the entire issue that was raised, was the valuation issue. Right? And you have done away with it. If you can just explain to us.
Right, so you see the provision, Section 56 said that if the shares have been issued at a value which is higher than their actual value, which means the implication then is that unaccounted funds have come into it, that's what the inference is there, then how do you come to or compute the amount of excess? To compute the amount of excess, you have to have a valuation as to what is the actual value and what have you received. So if the company has issued 10 rupees shares at a premium of 1,000 rupees, where we will value those shares and find out, let's say it's the value is 20, you've taken 1,000, so 980 is the excess that you've got.
Right.
And that is what we tax.
Right.
Now we're not on the business of taxing. We already said that we don't want to tax in these companies.
Right.
So now we say, as long as you don't invest in these categories,
specified categories mentioned in the...
As long as you use your funds genuinely in your business of a genuine startup, we are not concerned with the valuation.
Right. So my last question then is, you said that, you know, as far as, you know, activity in the ordinary course of business is concerned, that can be carried out.
That's right. Right?
If you can explain that, because, you know, for example, if I have a jewelry business or if I have a business of money lending,
right,
can I then get exemptions listed in this?
Yes. So if you read the notification, one of the banned categories is loans and advances, because we find that in many cases, unaccounted funds are laundered through company after company by way of loans or advances. But then there are some starters we know who are in the business of lending money. They would have credit agencies or credit companies. And so we have said in the notification, if the lending of or loans or advances are in the ordinary course of money lending business, then you can go ahead. That's not a banned activity.
Gotcha. Thank you so much for joining CNBC.
And staying with the startup space, a few months after sealing the $16 billion deal with Walmart, Flipkart co-founder Sachin Bansal has invested 650 crore rupees in the ride-hailing app Ola. This makes it the largest investment by an individual into the company. Mugdha Varia joins us with all the details. Mugdha, so what are you picking up regarding that investment by Sachin Bansal?
Yes, you're right. You know, Sachin Bansal has made a massive investment of rupees 650 crore in Ola, you know, and this will be the largest investment by an individual in Ola till date. And remember, Sachin Bansal had walked away with nearly $1 billion last year when he sold his stake in Flipkart after it was bought over by Walmart. And, you know, he's said to be looking at several investments and has also set up a separate holding company through which he wants to make investments. But even during his Flipkart days, Sachin Bansal has been an active investor. And, you know, some of his notable investments were in electric vehicle startup Aether Energy and medical tech company Sigtuple. And Ola, on the other hand, has been steadily raising capital, you know, ramping its valuation up to $6 billion. And it has itself been, making increasing acquisitions and investments such as Foodpanda and Riddler in the public transportation space last year, and recently its investment in bike sharing app Vogo.
Right, Mukta, many thanks for joining us with all the details from there. On to markets, where it's another day, another sell-off. It was the eighth straight day of losses for the benchmark indices on Dalal Street. The Nifty and Sensex ending the day over 0.25% lower, with the Nifty at the 10,600 mark and the Sensex below 35,500. The midday rally got completely sold into, with the bears gaining momentum in the last 30 minutes of today's trading session. The broader markets fared slightly better, the Nifty Bank ending the day flat with a slight positive bias, while the mid-cap saw mild outperformance. Now, in a bid to ease the debt burden, Anil Ambani's Reliance Power is likely to sell about 18-19% promoter stake in the company. Remember, Reliance Infra and its promoters currently hold 70%, and post the deal, they'll hold 51% in the company. The potential suitors include Qatar Investment Authority, Abu Dhabi Investment Authority, Blackstone, TPG, as well as KKR. And there's also a twist in the JP Infratech debt resolution matter. The promoters of the company have made a last attempt to save their company from going under insolvency. Banking sources tell us that JP Associates have made a settlement offer to financial creditors as well as home buyers. Ritu Singh is here with more. Ritu, what are you picking up?
In a move that is very similar to what the Ruyas tried to pull off with SR Steel, we're given to understand now that the promoters of JP Infratech are looking to withdraw the company from insolvency proceedings under Section 12A of the IBC by offering to repay the creditors close to the full amount that is owed to them. We're given to understand that the promoters, JP Associates, have presented this offer to the creditors, where they've offered 1,500 crore rupees as upfront payment to the IDBI-led consortium. In addition, they've also offered another 4,858 crore rupees as debt asset swap to the lenders for the land that is sitting with JP Infratech, and another 2,000 crore rupees as optionally convertible debentures. But they have sought complete waiver on repayment of 1,425 crore rupees that is owed as interest payment to the IDBI-led consortium. In addition to this offer to the financial creditors, what they've offered to the home buyers is a 50% waiver on the stamp duty, free maintenance charges for 1 1 year and 2,000 shares each to all the home buyers of JP Infratech. Now, it remains to be seen whether or not, the lenders will pay heed to such an offer, which they've not done in the past when, it was the case of Ruya's. Do remember, NBCC, as we had reported, is leading the race to acquire JP Infratech, where NBCC has offered about 1,000 crore rupees as upfront payment to the lenders compared to 10 crore rupees that has been offered by Suraksha Group. In addition, NBCC has also offered 3,000 crore rupees as debt asset swap compared to 5,000 crore rupees offered by Suraksha Group. And NBCC has offered to raise a fresh debt of 2,000 crore rupees, out of which 1,000 crores will be used to finish the construction of the project and another 1,000 crore rupees to repay the financial creditors of JP Infratech. The time taken by both also varies. So all of these details will now have to be studied by the lenders before they finally get to voting who the highest bidder will be.
Right, Ritu, many thanks for bringing us all the details from there. Now, the GST Council is meeting tomorrow, and we learned from sources that rates on real estate and the lottery business will be taken up for discussion. But some opposition parties are opposed to the idea of holding this meeting via video conferencing. Shireen Bhan is here, and she's joined by the Chief Minister of Puducherry, V. Narayan Swamy. Over to you, Shireen.
Well, joining us now to take this conversation forward is the Chief Minister of Puducherry, Mr. Narayan Swamy. Sir, thanks very much for joining us. I understand that you, along with several other state finance ministers, have written to the Union Finance Minister, Arun Jaitley, about the GST Council meeting tomorrow. What exactly is the issue that you've raised?
In fact, the agenda which you have received relating to the real estate and lottery, mm-hmm. both issues were in the agenda earlier when we had a meeting in Delhi. And we discussed those issues at a preliminary level. And those two issues are have got wide ramifications.
Yeah.
And only the GST Council meeting, what all the issues that is coming out in the lottery matter and also on the question of real estate issue.
Right.
It can be resolved not through video conference.
Okay.
Therefore, I thought it fit, and also some of our colleagues, the Honorable Finance Ministers of various states, and we have written letter to the Honorable Finance Minister, the Chairman of the GST Council, to postpone the meeting, to have a regular meeting,
Okay. Even
on a shorter date. We are willing to come and discuss the issue, and then we can find a solution.
Which are the other states that have written to the Union Finance Minister along with you?
To my knowledge, the Kerala, the Karnataka, the Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan, all the states.
Okay.
All the states have written.
So let me understand this. Your issue is not with the agenda item. Your issue is with the fact that the meeting of the GST Council is scheduled via video conference. Or do you have problems
with the recommendations itself?
Because the recommendations have been made by the GOM that was set up.
No. That GOM might have given its recommendation. But the thing is that, through video conference, we cannot elaborately discuss the issues arising out of the subject.
Right. No, so let me try and understand, what are the specific issues that you have? Because the proposal of the GST Council's GOM that was set up was that there should be a 3% GST without input tax credit. Now, do you have issues with that proposal? What are the specific problems that you have with the recommendations made by the GOM?
No, all these things we will reply in the meeting. I cannot discuss in the media on this. I am telling in general, the larger issues are involved in both the subjects.
Okay.
Therefore, we want regular discussion to take place in the GST Council. It should take place.
So, has there been any response that's come in from the Union Finance Minister? Is the meeting tomorrow?
Letter. Just now I sent a letter to him.
Okay.
I am waiting for his response from the Honorable Chairman of the GST Council.
But the meeting is tomorrow. Did you only get the agenda item today? Why is the request being made today?
No, I got the agenda about a week, 4-5 days back. I had to go through the agenda item.
Right.
All of a sudden, I cannot write to him unless until I apply my mind.
Okay. So you've made the request as of today for a council meeting that is scheduled for tomorrow?
Yeah.
So what is the likelihood that... that if the Union Finance Minister doesn't respond in the affirmative, what happens then?
No, I don't want to answer all these hypothetical questions. Let the Honorable the Finance Minister respond to our letter. Okay.
All right, Mr. Narayanaswamy, thanks very much for joining us. Well, that's the Chief Minister of Puducherry, who also represents his state in the GST Council, saying that along with other state finance ministers, Puducherry has asked for rescheduling the GST Council meeting, which was expected to take place tomorrow via video conference, essentially to deal with issues related to the real estate sector as well as lotteries. So whether or not this is actually going to be accepted by the Union Finance Ministers, also the chairperson of the GST Council, is the big question. But a request being made by several state governments. Remember now, the constituency of opposition states has gone up in the GST Council. The composition of the GST Council has also changed. Will the Union Finance Minister reschedule the meeting is the big question.
5 days after 40 CRPF jawans were killed in a terror attack in Pulwama, Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan has broken his silence. In a televised statement, Imran Khan denied any Pakistani involvement in the attack and blamed India for playing judge and jury. Now, claiming that Pakistan has nothing to benefit by attacking India, Imran Khan also warned that there will be retaliation if India chooses to attack. Just a day after the attack, Finance Minister Arun Jaitley said there is incontrovertible evidence of Pakistan's direct involvement in the attack. The Jaish-e-Mohammed has claimed responsibility for that attack, and the founder of the terror outfit, Masood Azhar, is currently residing in Pakistan.
Agar aap ye samajhte hain ki aap Pakistan ke upar kuch kisi kisam ka hamla karenge, Pakistan retaliate karne ka sochega nahi. Pakistan retaliate karega. हम सब जानते हैं कि जंग शुरू करना आसान है. शुरू करना तो जंग इंसान के हाथ में होती है, लेकिन जंग खत्म करना इंसान के हाथ में नहीं होती. ये मसला जो आखिर में हल होगा, जिस तरह अफगानिस्तान में, ये भी डायलॉग और बातचीत से हल होगा. पहले तो आपने पाकिस्तान पे इल्जाम लगा दिया, ना कोई एविडेंस, ना कोई सोचा कि इसके अंदर पाकिस्तान का क्या फायदा है. अगर आपके पास कोई एक्शनेबल इंटेलिजेंस है कि पाकिस्तान इन्वॉल्व है, वो हमें दे. मैं आपको गारंटी करता हूं कि हम एक्शन लेंगे. एक इंट्रोस्पेक्शन आनी चाहिए कि क्या वजह है. कश्मीर के नौजवान उस इंतहा पे पहुंच चुके हैं जो वो मौत का उनका खौफ ही उतर गया.
Right, so the Pakistani Prime Minister there saying that Pakistan is not involved in the in that attack and asking for evidence in that matter. And a day after three alleged terrorists of the Jaish-e-Mohammed were killed in an encounter, the Indian Army said that the entire leadership of the terror outfit has been eliminated from the Kashmir Valley. The Army also appealing to the mothers of Kashmir to request their sons who have joined terror outfits to surrender and join the mainstream. Addressing the media, Lieutenant General Kamaljeet Singh Dhillon also issued a warning that anyone picking up the gun will be eliminated.
Through you, I would request all the mothers of Kashmir to please request their sons who have joined terrorism to surrender and get back to the mainstream. Anyone who has picked up gun in Kashmir will be eliminated unless he surrenders.
And with that, it's a wrap on this edition of Reporter's Diary. Many thanks for watching, but do stay tuned to CNBC TV 18. Coming up next is a special show on the Pulwama terror attacks.